Meet Electron Rocket Lab's state-of-the-art all-carbon composite launch vehicle. This is a totally different way to build a rocket.
Space is now open for business.
And we've already had multiple successful re-entries and also two successful splashdowns.
We have several planetary missions in development today. Later this year, we'll launch to the moon with NASA for the Capstone mission, which is the first launch of the Artemis program. Then we'll move on to Mars with two spacecraft for the NASA Escapade mission. And we've also announced a privately funded mission to Venus to search for life in the atmosphere.
Oh, I love Venus the most, for sure. I mean, Mars is great and all, and the moon's pretty awesome, but Venus has the potential for life. And if we look at our near-Earth objects, I mean, Mars potentially had life, and who knows what we'll find there, but Venus is incredibly, you know, understudied, and I think there's a tremendous amount to learn. And if you look at Venus and Earth, they are the two closest planets to each other, and Venus is just Earth gone really bad, so wouldn't it be good to go and take a look at that?
Founded in 2006 by Peter Beck, Rocket Lab is a New Zealand-founded company with launch sites in the United States and on the Mahia Peninsula of New Zealand. Initial investment in Rocket Lab came primarily from Mark Rocket. Yep, that's right, I said Rocket. Mark, along with Peter, shared director duties from 2007 till 2011, when Mark stepped back from Rocket Lab, allowing Peter Beck sole director duties.
First launching late November of 2009 with the other one sounding rocket, the New Zealand-based Rocket Lab claimed the title of first private company in the Southern Hemisphere to reach space. Atea 1 launched from the Great Mercury Island owned by New Zealand banker and investor Michael Fay.
By 2013, Rocket Lab had outgrown its New Zealand roots and moved registration to the USA, with its headquarters initially being located in Huntington Beach, California. As of 2020, they moved headquarters once again to Long Beach, California.
Later funding for Rocket Lab came in 2013 by Kosla Ventures and Callaghan Innovation, and by 2014, Bessemer Venture Partners had also invested, with Lockheed Martin becoming a strategic investor as of 2015. By 2017, Rocket Lab announced it had gained an additional $75 million from a private funding round, with a further $150 million being raised in 2018 through another private funding round.
The Athia rocket was 6 meters or 20 foot long and 60 kilograms, 130 pounds, and was designed for a 2 kilogram payload, took flight on November 30th, 2009. Splashed down 50 kilometers downrange. The booster stage for this launch was recovered, but due to no downlink, Rocket Lab were unable to recover the payload. After months of development towards the Athia 2, Rocket Lab decided to scrap this project in favor of the later Electron. The Electron rocket has fast become the workhorse of the small satellite industry. It is a two-stage launch system and the world's first to be made wholly from carbon composites.
Electron is 18 meters in height with a diameter of 1.2 meters. That's quite a bit smaller compared to the SpaceX's Falcon 9 rocket, which comes in at 70 meters in height. You could almost fit Electron in the payload fairing of a Falcon 9. Fully fueled, Electron weighs 13 tons and can deliver up to 300 kilograms to orbit for a cost of $7.5 million per launch. On top of the two stages, Electron has a kick stage.
The name Electron comes from the way of powering the engine with turbo pumps. Instead of wasted fuel like many rockets do to spin the pumps, so they have batteries to run turbo pumps, hence being able to run the tanks really empty if needed.
For a small sat launcher, this engineering feat works well and has been reproduced by other companies. For bigger rockets, battery power would not be nearly as simple with added mass. Electron's upper stage even does a battery swap on the fly, dropping half of the batteries when they are empty to burn up in the atmosphere. Without this, their payload to orbit would be minimal. Another advantage of the battery power is that when batteries are developed further in the other industries, Rocket Lab can just collect the benefits without making an investment themselves. First launching on 25th May 2017, with the launch It's a test from Launch Complex 1, which ended up in failure technically. After reaching an altitude of about 224 kilometers, the rocket was performing nominally, but telemetry was lost, so the decision to destroy it was made by range safety.
Less than a year after the first launch resulted in a failure, Rocket Labs returned with still testing, launch number 2. On January the 21st, 2018, from LC1 in New Zealand, it included 3 CubeSats, most notable of which was Humanity Star. This was a 3-foot-wide satellite, similar to a disco ball, and according to Rocket Labs, was sent up as a bright symbol and reminder to all on Earth about our fragile place in the universe.
Later that year, Rocket Lab returned for attempt number 3, named It's Business Time, launching from LC1, which included 4 CubeSats.
Little over a month later came launch number 4, on the 16th of December 2018, with the name This Is For Pickering, named after the New Zealand-born rocket scientist Bill Pickering, and saw another successful launch and a handful of CubeSats. This mission was significant for Rocket Labs, as it was their first launch with NASA as a customer.
Next came Two Thumbs Up, launching from LC1 on 28th of March 2019, and launched a single satellite, R3D2, radio frequency risk reduction deployment demonstration for DARPA, the American Advanced Technologies Department.
Launch number 6 for Rocket Lab was This Is a Funny Looking Cactus, launching the 5th of May 2019, again from LC1 on the Maahia Peninsula of New Zealand. This launch was part of the United States Air Force RALI, or Rapid Agile Launch Initiative. And this was Rocket Lab's heaviest payload to date, weighing 180 kilograms or 400 pounds.
With a quick launch cadence, Rocket Lab launched Make It Rain on 29th of June 2019, again from LC1 for Black Sky Global Satellite Constellation, and included CubeSats from the Melbourne Space Program.
Next came Look Ma, No Hands on 19th of August 2019, and it included more of the Black Sky Global Constellation and 2 experimental satellites for the Air Force Space Command.
17th October 2019 saw the launch of As the Crow Flies, with a kickstage demonstration mission that soared to 1,200 kilometers above Earth's atmosphere before deorbiting itself.
6th of December 2019 saw Rocket Lab fly Running Out of Fingers, a tribute to the 10th launch from the New Zealand-founded company, and was the first mission that Rocket Lab tracked full telemetry of the booster as it fell back to Earth as part of pathfinding missions for reusability for the company.
31st of January 2020 saw Rocket Lab Birds of a Feather launch the classified payload Enrol 151, launched from LC1 for the NRO, National Reconnaissance Office, and a controlled re-entry test once again for the Electron first stage.
13th of June 2020, Rocket Lab again rolled the carbon fiber Electron rocket out to the pad, this time for Don't Stop Me Now, launching a further 3 classified payloads for the NRO and a Pathfinder unit for the Photon kickstage.
Pix, or It Didn't Happen, marked only the second failure for the Rocket Lab due to an issue with the second stage after launching on 4th July 2020. The issue was found to be an issue with a faulty electrical connection causing the electric turbopump for the Rutherford engine to shut down.
7 weeks after the failure of the ironic Pix, or It Didn't Happen, Rocket Lab returned to the launch pad on the Maahia Peninsula of New Zealand once again. I Can't Believe It's Not Optical launched on the 31st of August 2020 and saw the first use of a market-ready photon kickstage.
In Focus would follow 2 months later with customer payloads for Canon Electronics and Planet Labs on the 28th October 2020.
And on the 20th of November, Rocket Lab rolled out Return to Sender. This was unique as it had a red section on the top of the first stage Electron. This was to house parachutes and would see the first soft water landing and vessel recovery for Rocket Lab.
The All's Night Begins launched 15 December 2020 with a payload for customers' inspective.
20th of January 2021, and another one leaves the crust, launched a payload for OHB, which is Europe's third biggest space corporation.
22nd March 2021, They Go Up So Fast launched and saw two milestones for Rocket Lab. First, the 100th satellite, and second was Pathstone for pathfinding mission for the NASA Artemis program and the Rocket Lab private mission to Venus, the latter of which is planned for late 2021.
15th of May 2021, Rocket Labs found themselves running out of tours. Launch 20 for the company saw its third failure. The second stage shut down early, causing the payload to be lost, but they did, however, manage to make the second successful ocean landing of the Electron first stage.
And finally, at the time of recording this, the last launch for Rocket Lab was It's a Little Chilly Up There. Due to launch from Wallops LC2, but due to issues certifying the autonomous flight termination system for use in the USA, it was decided that they would instead launch from New Zealand once more and launch the classified monolith satellite for the United States Space Force on July 29, 2021.
On December 9, 2019, Rocket Lab released a video showing off Rosie. Rosie is a custom-built 140 square meter robot that enables precision matching of Electron's carbon composite structures, including first and second stage fairings, in just 12 hours. All the making, cutting, drilling, milling and sanding is complete on one vehicle.
August 2019, Peter Beck came on stage for a special announcement that Rocket Lab was going reusable and planned to catch the Electron core stage with a helicopter using a technique known as mid-air retrieval. In effect, they will catch the booster after re-entry via the parachute cords and a catching hook.
Many people assumed this was the first time we would see the mid-air retrieval technique used. However, it is not. NASA and the United States Air Force use this technique to capture tape buckets from early spy satellites, though this will be the first time it's been done with a rocket booster. Peter Beck had repeatedly said that Rocket Lab would not pursue reusability for their rockets and never fly people. But starting to pursue reusability with the announcement, Peter was forced to say he'd eat his hat for being dishonest. Manufactured in the company's Long Beach headquarters, the Loxon RP-1 fed Rutherford engine is not only the world's first fully 3D printed engine, but also the world's first electric powered turbopump engine. 9 of these are used on the Electron first stage, and 1 vacuum optimized version is used for the second stage. It was qualified for use in March 2016, and saw its maiden flight on the 25th of May 2017. At the time of this recording, over 210 Rutherford engines have been flown to space.
Launch Complex 1. The world's first privately funded and built launch site wholly owned and operated by Rocket Lab is situated on the southern tip of Mahia Peninsula on New Zealand's North Island. The launch site officially opened on 26th September 2016.
I finally ate the hat. The avoidance of all doubt, this hat is not tasty. But there's some things we said we'd never do. But we're going to build a big rocket.
It's an 8-ton class launch vehicle, and of course, it's reusable. But one thing that's probably more exciting and most unusual for Rocket Lab is that this vehicle is capable of human spaceflight. Launching 2024.
We are going to build a big rocket, described by Peter Beck as a purpose-built mega-constellation building machine. An 8-ton class rocket for building the mega-constellations of today and tomorrow. And capable of human spaceflight, the rocket is expected to launch in 2024.